Hey everybody, and welcome to the 20th episode of Dark Matter Knits. It's November 21st, 2014, and I'm Elizabeth Green Musselman. Hello! So today's episode is called Alternating Skeins, and the idea behind the theme is that there are times when you literally need to alternate skeins, either because you're striping or working with a hand-dyed yarn, and I'm going to talk about, you know, what are some of the best ways to manage your yarns when you're needing to do that. So that'll be the technique segment at the end. And then I'm going to kind of talk about alternating skeins more as a metaphor, like changing things up. So I've changed a lot of things up this week, and that's what I'll be talking about. So a few businessy kind of things first. One is that on the last episode when I was reviewing the lovely Bijou Basin Ranch yarn and their new Allure fiber wash, I was making fun of Allure for putting the fact that it was gluten-free on their packaging. And I knew as soon as those words started coming out of my mouth, the snark started to leave the building, that I was wrong, that somebody was going to point out that actually it is important that wool wash is gluten-free. And of course it is. Of course it is. So it turns out that if you have a very high sensitivity to gluten, it actually can be a tactile thing too. Like you can have skin reactions to gluten. So apparently it does matter that wool washes are gluten-free or not. Who knew? I should have. Well, maybe I shouldn't have, but you know, just goes to show you. Snark gets you nowhere. It's actually gotten me pretty far. But thanks to those of you who had pointed that out to me on YouTube, thanks for pointing it out, because actually it was good to know. It was actually N.A. Forever and Sarah Hepworth pointed that out to me, so thank you for doing that. I also want to go ahead and follow up on the giveaway from Jennifer Lassonde, Boston Jen, from last week. She very kindly offered a copy of her new pattern, the Ayla Grace shawl, to give away to one of our viewers. And so I did a drawing ahead of time, and the winner is number 13, who is L Brown 8655. So I'm going to send your name along to Jennifer, and she's going to send you a copy of the pattern. So congratulations. And if you didn't win it, just go get a copy of it. Support your indie designers, man. Speaking of which, today is the last day of the gift along, and if I can actually manage to get this uploaded on Friday, you have until midnight Eastern time in the U.S. to take advantage of the sale from the gift along. So the basic idea is that there are a little under 300 designers on Ravelry who are putting up many of their patterns for sale for 25% off. That sale ends tonight at midnight Eastern time, but the knit along and crochet along goes on through the end of the year. So there are, with the knit along and crochet along is, there's a group for it, the Indie Design Gift Along, and I'll link to all this in the show notes, but you can show what you're working on. And there are also these fun games that have just started where you can, you try to guess, you know, the name has been removed from a designer's logo and you have to try to guess who it is. Or they do these rebus things where you have to guess what pattern the pictures symbolize. So just, you know, kind of fun little things, and there are prizes for each one of those games that people win. So it's very cool. The other sort of, you know, like what I've been up to this week or newsy kind of thing is that I went to Kid and You this past weekend, and it wasn't this past weekend, it was a couple weekends ago, but I don't think I had, have I talked to you since I went? No, I was going the day after I recorded my last episode. So Kid and You, really, really fun, and this is part of my alternating skeins, changing things up theme. I'm really glad I went. I was not sure I was going to go because it's kind of a small festival, and I've just done, you know, I've done a fair amount of traveling recently, and I can just be kind of lazy sometimes. But my friend Heidi, who is the host of, well, she's the owner of Undead Yarns. She's a dyer, and she also does the Undead Yarns podcast. She asked if I wanted to go, so we drove out together, which was really fun. It was nice to have I don't normally have a friend to pal around those things with, so that was really cool. And neither one of us was taking classes. We just kind of walked around the marketplace and talked to people, and I did end up buying a couple of things. I totally forgot to bring them over here, too. Hang on. I'll be right back. So yeah, I did pick up a few things. One of them was this cool thing. This is a shawl pin. Isn't it neat? It is made out of copper, or at least it's copper plated. I'm not sure it's copper all the way through. And Anna Clerk, who is the dyer behind Yarn Carnival, I'm going to write down that I mentioned her. Her husband actually makes these. So Yarn Carnival is a really cool dyeing business. It's local to me in Austin. And then her husband started making these shawl pins. And I really liked this one because of how simple it is. And, you know, you can just kind of poke it through whatever you're wearing. I don't know. It wasn't too cute. It wasn't too feminine. It's just kind of like it does the job, which I really liked about it. But it's very cool looking at the same time. Very sturdy. So I really liked that. I also stopped at the Woolly Wonka booth and had talked to the dyer behind Woolly Wonka before, Ann Podlasek, but I had never met her in person. So it was really nice to see her. And I picked up one of her transitional skein kits, or sets, I guess. Look how lovely this is. Isn't that nice? So it's not quite a gradient, but you could certainly do a gradient kind of effect with it. It's 400 yards altogether, so it's basically the same as a, you know, a kind of standard skein of sock yarn. It's superwash wool, and I basically got it in these colors because I wanted to. I'm probably going to make something for my sister with it, and she really loves blue, and she looks beautiful in it. So I got that, and I also got, dang it, I don't have it with me. I was so good about packing up all my stuff, and then I took some of it with me to a thing a little bit ago. Anyway, I also bought at the Knitting Fairy booth. Knitting Fairy is a local yarn store that's up near Dallas. I got a 9-inch circular needle. This is just the packaging. The needle's not in here because it is currently being used to knit something. But I saw that she had these, and this is a size 1, 2.25 millimeter. So a 9-inch circular is where, you know, it really is like maybe just a little bit longer than what my finger and thumb are doing. But it basically allows you to knit around a small circumference with one circular needle without having to do magic loop or something like that. So I've always wanted to try it and see if it would work. Like, the problem that a lot of people have with it is that the needle tips have to be so short. Like, they're really only about maybe 2 inches long. They have to be really short in order to be able to, you know, kind of still make a circular shape. But it turns out that the key to whether you're going to like it or not is how you hold your needles. So it turns out that the way I hold my needles, I'm going to use a different thing to show you this. This isn't the small circular. But when I knit, I hold my needles like this. And that, if you hold your needles like that, you're probably going to be fine with a 9-inch circular. If you hold your needles like this, you kind of grip it with your whole hand, then you're probably not going to like it. Like, I know I've heard Leslie from the Knit Girls say that she, you know, kind of likes to rest the end of the circular needle. She kind of needs it to be hitting her palm. So if you're that, if you're knitting in that way, then I don't think you're going to like 9-inch circulars. But if you kind of clasp it more with the tips of your fingers, then give it a shot, because it's kind of neat. I mean, it still takes a little getting used to. And I don't know that I would use it for everything. I still like Magic Loop, but it was fun to try it. You know, changing it up. I'm just trying new things, because I'm crazy like that. Yeah, so that's what I got. I tried to keep it fairly limited. I wasn't going to buy anything, and then I did it anyway. But yeah, Kid Me was really fun, and I got to see all kinds of other Texas podcasters there, which was really fun, and yeah, just got some good business kind of things dealt with. Anne and I from Woolly Wonka are talking about doing something really cool, about which more later. And one of the vendors wanted to buy some wholesale patterns from me because she saw me wearing my hat. Designers always wear your stuff to shows. I just did it because I was cold. And then all these people were like, oh, I really like your hat. Like, oh yeah, I guess it is kind of smart to wear your own designs when you go out amongst knitters. Always thinking, even when I don't realize I am. So what I've been knitting on, really the two main things that I've been knitting on, one of them I don't have with me at the moment, but it is, I think I showed part of it to you last week. I'm, my purse knitting basically is a pair of fingerless gloves that I'm knitting using this yarn. Mustache Yarns Perfect Sock self-striping in one of her OCD colorways, Dark Side of the Moon. This is the one that the Yarn Harlot blogged about, so sorry to even show it to you, but you're probably not going to be getting it anytime soon, because poor Stacy has been dyeing this until her fingers bleed. But she has lots of really cool colorways, and the cool thing about the OCD thing is that basically what she does is she splits the sock yarn skein into two equal skeins and then dyes them identically, so that you get, if you're making two things, like a pair of socks or a pair of mitts or whatever, they will begin at exactly the same point in the striping sequence, which is pretty cool. I mean, I actually like mismatched things, but this is a neat innovation, I suppose, is the right word for it. So I've been working on that. And then the other thing main thing I've been working on is, besides some design stuff that I can't show you, unfortunately, is the stuff is a sample in the yarn that I'm reviewing today. So I will just go ahead and get to that. So I'm reviewing a yarn today, and it is October House Fiber Arts. And here it is. Isn't it pretty? So here's her label. I'll get back to the label in a moment, but look at this. Sorry, I won't get boogies on your yarn. This is yours to win, about which more in a moment. Look at it. Look at it. Look. Oh, there's my mail. Butterscotchy. Oh, it's so lovely. I'm trying to kind of turn it in all different directions so that you can see just how beautiful that is. You know what? I'm realizing I am going to need to pause this, because not only is the other project that I was working on in my bag in the other room, so is the shawl I've been working on with this. Good God, y'all. Back in a moment. Okay. So here, since I can show you this now, this is the mustache fingerless mitt that I'm making with the Dark Side of the Moon colorway. And just a simple mitt. There's the 9-inch needle, so you can see what that looks like. And it's obviously a reference to the Pink Floyd album and the cover art on it. But I just wanted to show you, you know, when I knit, I basically, you know, kind of do it like this. So you see how I'm really just kind of pinching the needles in my fingers? If I were holding it like this, I think I would just kind of go berserk. because it kind of clamps down too much of the cable at the same time, and then there's less flexibility on the cable to be able to maneuver around. So that is my kind of purse knitting. Now back to October House. So I want to tell you a little bit about the company first before I get started on the yarn specifically. So this is October House Fiber Arts, and it is a relatively new company. I believe she started about maybe a year and a half ago, dying. And her name is Robin Sample, and she is from Hot Springs National Park in Arkansas. And I met her in Hot Springs at the Arkansas Fiber Arts Extravaganza, where she was vending. And I think it was either her first show or one of her first shows where she was vending. And she's actually going to be at DFW Fiber Fest in March. If you are planning on going to that event, you will see her there. So she's getting started with vending, but she's got a... I was really, really impressed with her. She is the kind of person that when she starts something, she goes all in. You know what I mean? I mean, I think it's perfectly normal and acceptable for somebody when they're first starting out in a small business to, you know, to kind of take it slow and try out a few things, and some things fail, and, you know, you don't really have your logo set yet and your look, and you're kind of experimenting with colors and so on. That's not how Robin does things. This woman has a complete aesthetic and look. I mean, she looks like she's been doing this for at least a decade. So look at this tag, for example. Now, maybe it's just because I'm a graphic designer, but I just, like, all of her stuff. This was the thank you card that came with the review skein that she sent me. And she's got these lovely yarn labels on this really nice cardstock with this cute little illustration that she told me she painted in watercolors. And, you know, just all of her stuff has a unified look to it. And not only that, but also her entire shop has a palette, like a recognizable unified palette. So here is her, Lord, here is her webpage. Is this going to work? There we go. That's a little better. You can see how, here, let me see if I, oh yeah, there we go. If I turn this way, you can see it a little better. See how the whole look of the webpage has this sunbathed kind of farm dappled palette to it. Sorry if that was nauseating. And then her colorways, which, by the way, she lists all of her repeatable colorways on her site, which I really appreciate, because it can be frustrating sometimes when you go to somebody's shop and, you know, there's just like the stuff they have up now, but maybe you'd like to see what they have in general, not just right this moment. There we go. So she's got this really gorgeous palette that really all works together. You know, it's very autumnal, as October House would suggest. And there are cool colors in there, like some, you know, kind of light teals and pinks, but they all kind of conform to this unified palette. You may remember, if you've been watching a while, I got this fiber from her when I was at Arkansas Fiber Arts, and it again, kind of fits into this nice palette. Like the purple, even though there's some cool colors in here, it all works together within the kind of fall leaves scheme. So there's a lot of variety, don't get me wrong. But you can readily identify her booth because it has this very unified look to it. I was really charmed by, well, really lots of things about her, but especially by the story that she tells about herself on her website. So I want to read you a little part of this. She says, when I was a little girl, I would spend hours in my bedroom playing by myself, inventing little worlds and creating my own stores, houses, stories, and props. My mom would sometimes stick her head in and ask me, "Robin, are you doing okay?" And I would answer, "I'm fine," and go back to my little world. I'll always be grateful that my mom gave me that time to be with myself, that she didn't think there was something else I needed to be doing or other people I needed to be with. She saw that I was happy and busy and nothing needed to be scheduled. Those days gave me the rich world inside my head that I draw upon today, crafting and creating, looking at the world through my own set of eyes, seeing color combinations that I'm itching to recreate, watching images and scenes from my head appear on wool and silk. And she goes on a little bit more, but I just really resonated with that, you know, the spending lots of time alone in your room. And I don't know, I just thought that was really charming, you know, that she shared that about herself and that she gives you some sense of the inner world and the experience that this yarn and fiber is coming from. So basically what Robin does, what October House is I believe she started, yes, she started by dyeing fiber. And you will find that she has a lot of, I think she has something like 14 different varieties of fiber and five different bases for yarn. So she's clearly at this point more of a fiber dyer than a yarn dyer, although she certainly does plenty of both. So the fiber, like this one, is a merino bamboo nylon blend, which she calls Panda Superwash, Panda SW. So that's why it has that gorgeous sheen, is it's got bamboo in it. And she has tons of other, like I said, she has 14 different varieties of fiber base that she dyes, including silk hankies for spinning. And then she has five different bases of yarn, all of which are finer weights. There's one DK, but six different bases. One is DK, and then the other five are fingering or lace. And she also does 3, 6, and 12-month fiber clubs. There's one that just closed recently, but I think she has a waiting list going. And she also sells some patterns. So her shop is on Etsy, but she has her own site, OctoberHouseFiberArts.com. So a little more about the yarn itself. So this is the ball that I've been working from. And the camera is showing reasonably well just how rich the color is. And I want to show you a little bit of the garter stitch on the project I've been working on. I'll show you more of this in a moment, but you can kind of see just how rich and deep this color is. You know, it looks like it, compared to say a variegated color, it looks like it might be solid, but it's actually much more semi-solid, perhaps kettle dyed. There are some places that are more orange, some that are more gold. There are little places where bits of coppery green show through. There's really sort of endless variation in here, which always keeps the knitting interesting. There's a relatively tight twist on this yarn. This is a fingering weight. And so even though it's 100% superwash merino, it will wear pretty well. I mean, you wouldn't necessarily want to make socks that you're going to walk around in without shoes. But it's twisted pretty tightly. It would do well for, I haven't noticed any problems with pilling, and I doubt that I will. This is a very generous skein. The particular skein that I have is the trellis base, which, as I mentioned, is 100% superwash merino, and it is 460 yards, that's 421 meters, in a 100-gram skein, although actually my skein weighed 115 grams, so it's probably quite a few more yards. Some of that is probably dye. Like, I'm not quite sure about this, but I think the way that dyers do this is they wind a skein off of a cone that they've been shipped by the mill, and then they weigh it, you know, wind off 100 grams of it, and then they dye it. So I think that the dye actually adds some weight, but still, it's not 15 grams, the weight of the dye. So this is quite a generous skein. It's machine wash, of course, because it's superwash. And, you know, it's a kind of classic fingering weight gauge. And this color is ginger. So it's more than enough for a pair of socks, even if you're knitting for large feet or, you know, you want long legs on your project. And it's a great size for small shawls, which is what I'm doing with it. So I decided, this is what I'm making. Isn't this pretty? I love it so much. I love it. I'll tell you what it is in a minute. Hold your horses. Golly. So it's just beautiful. It's a lace shawlette garter stitch based. Let me show you what it is. So the pattern's called Pesto, and this is by Alan Lo Cicero. She goes by Freckles and Pearls on Ravelry, and here is her version. You can see why she called it Pesto, because hers is the color of the delicious, delicious sauce. It's really pretty, and the pattern is very well written. I have found no errors, had no problem understanding what she's getting at. It's very thorough. So I would definitely recommend the pattern, and I really like how it looks in this yarn. I will say that this is a classic example, kids, of do as I say and not as I do. Because do you remember when I said that in my best teacher voice that loosely plied two-ply yarns are better for lace and block out better, and that tightly twisted three or more ply yarns that are made for socks are not ideal for lace. Do you remember when I said that? Apparently I didn't. Yeah, that's exactly what this is. Tightly plied stuff made for socks. And look how much it boing, boings back. It's not going to want to block out too hard, which is kind of what you're supposed to do with this shawl. Like, you're really supposed to give it a good yoink this way and this way. It's not going to do it. So it's not going to be very long. Like, I can get this down my arm if I stretch it, but it's not going to stay there, I'll bet, once I block it. So I'm just going to make it as long as I can, and if I need to use my handy-dandy shawl pin to keep it closed, then I will. Because, frankly, okay, so the problem with doing it in this yarn, it's not the fault of the yarn or the pattern. Let me make this very clear. Fault of poor judgment on my part. But the problem is not so much, the problem is that it's not really going to stay stretched. So it's not really going to be very long this way. However, I am not disappointed in how the lace looks. Sometimes with plump yarns, you don't really get to see the lace very well because the plumpness just kind of fills in all those holes that you've been laboriously making with all your yarn overs. But in this case, the lace is open enough. There are rather large holes here and they're rather frequent. So I think that helps mitigate the problem. Like, you can really see the lace pattern. That is not an issue. So I'm going to call it a success. And I definitely, I think it would be fine to work this pattern in a sock yarn. Just make sure that ideally you would want to have maybe 500 yards, 450 at least, because you can make it a little longer. Basically what I'm going to do, I'm halfway through the pattern and I'm not halfway through the yarn. I don't really want it. I like the scarf quality of this, so I don't really want it to be any longer this way. So I'm just going to stop doing the increases here and kind of go straight for a little bit until I get halfway through the yarn, and then I'm going to go straight for the same number of rows that I went straight before I got to the halfway mark, if you know what I mean, and then start doing the decreases. That's what I'm going to do. So yeah, I have really loved working with this yarn. Let me see if there's something. Oh, I did want to mention, I have found a few places in the skein where the yarn had clearly broken at the mill. And typically mills have two ways of dealing with this. Either they're not going to just dump the skein, like that doesn't, well, maybe some do, but I don't think many of them do. They're going to do one of two things. They're either going to knot it, which I know drives some people crazy, or they're going to kind of do a version of spit splicing it together where it's not knotted, but there's like a little puffy bit. And let me see if I can find. There are some of those. The puffy thing I think is nicer because you don't have to undo a knot or deal with a knot. You still have one consistent skein of yarn, but like here's a little puffy bit. So there have been a couple of places where that's happened. I don't mind that at all. In fact, I think, like I said, it's a better solution to the problem of stuff just breaks than knotting it. But if that drives you crazy, now you know. Frankly, if it drives you crazy, you might as well just get over it because there really aren't many skeins of yarn where you're not going to find something like that. And it should be pointed out that this is less the dyer's fault and more the mill's fault. So dyers get yarn from mills. They don't usually spin the yarn themselves. And granted, they're choosing which mill to work with, but most mills are going to have knots or, the little joins. So what can you do? So, all in all, it's beautiful stuff, people. I mean, this woman deserves to be one of the most popular dyers out there. She does gorgeous, gorgeous stuff. Some variegated, some semi-solid, mostly semi-solid in the yarns. You gotta get yourself some of this, especially if, like me, you're a warm color person and you really love fall. Good stuff. So she has very generously sent, as I mentioned, this one is for you. Well, maybe not you specifically, but hopefully you specifically. Somebody, one of you, is going to win this game. And not only that, wait, there's more. She also sent some stitch markers for you. So this is a little package of six plain metal ring, well, not plain, but like the standard kind of metal ring stitch markers. They're really pretty and very functional. I love using these kinds of stitch markers. They fit up to a size 10, as you can see there. And I don't think she sells these in her shop. I think she just brings them along when she goes to events. But these two together will go to one of you lucky people. And your task, should you choose to accept it, is to go to the Ravelry group. If you haven't already joined, you'll need to join in order to be eligible for the giveaway. And I want you to tell me what memories, the October House palette evokes for you. So you're going to need to go look at her page and kind of get a sense of her aesthetic and the colors that she uses. And I want you to tell us about something that this makes you remember, this particular color scheme. The colors evoke memories for you? I'm sure they do. Like, we're fiber artists, right? So that is October House Fiber Arts, and I want to thank Robin for being so generous with sending me. She sent me stitch markers and me a skein, and then she sent you stitch markers and you a skein. She was really nice, and I know, especially when you're getting started, that's a real commitment to do that. So thank you very much. All right, so last thing for today, technique segment. So a while ago, I started a thread on the Ravelry group that asked you to give me some ideas about what kind of technique segments you'd like to see. And a number of you posted, and I have followed up on a couple of those, but I just remembered, I haven't gone back and looked at those again. So I just went back today, and I thought I would answer basically a couple of questions that, on the face of it, seem different, but they end up having the same answer. So Hallie Sherry, I hope I'm saying that right, asked about how to carry yarn when you're doing a striped shawl. So something like, say, the Color Affection shawl. What's the best way to carry the yarns up the side when you're doing a shawl like this or a project that has thin stripes? And Shepherd's Knits asked about alternating skeins when knitting with a hand-dyed yarn. So if you've knit with hand-dyed yarn, you know that in some cases, particularly if you've gotten a different dye lot, but sometimes even within the same dye lot, there might be enough variation in color between skeins that you want to alternate back and forth. So Madeline Tosh is a classic one for this. Love their yarns, but man, inconsistencies all over the place in terms of what the colorway looks like. So you might get one that's a little darker and one that's a little lighter, one that has a little more blue and one that has a little less. So unless you want like a really clear line between where one skein stopped and the next began, the advice that they often use for hand-dyed yarn is to alternate skeins like on every other row. If you're working in the round, well, either way, in the round or flat, basically knit two rows with one skein and knit two rows with another. So the answer to those two questions ends up being the same, right? Because basically you're doing the same thing in each case. You're alternating between two skeins. So how do you do that? Well, there's not, basically you don't want to overthink it. I mean, with a project like the Color Affection Shawl, I just taught a class on this, so I happen to have it handy. This is a very, very popular pattern on Ravelry by Vera Velimaki. And one of the things that happens is that when you get to the point in the pattern where you've got all three colors going, she tells you don't cut the yarns, and boy, would you drive yourself crazy, right? If you cut your yarn every single time you changed colors. Am I right? So don't do that. But you do have to carry those yarns up. This is actually the side. What looks like the top of the shawl is actually the side when you're knitting it. And so let's say you've just used navy blue, and then you do the silver, and then you do the green, and now you're back to navy blue. That blue has to travel up four rows to get to the next place that it's used. And if you don't do that really, really loosely, you're going to be sorry, because this whole edge will get really bunched up. So you do it super loose. And she recommends twisting the yarns around each other, which I don't think is really necessary in the specific case of the Color Affection shawl. But, oh Lord. Hi, I'm sorry. Did you fall down? Sorry. I hope that wasn't loud if you're wearing earbuds. All right, so let's take a look at that. Here's a giganto version of the Color Affection shawl. Look how far I got. So basically you're doing a striped project here. And if you're asking about alternating hand-dyed skeins, you could just imagine that this is from one skein and this is from another, right? So I've just finished knitting with the gray, and now I need to go back to the hot pink. But my hot pink is down here, and it needs to carry up to here. So one of the things that you may want to do when particularly when you're actually doing stripes, not so much when you're doing it with hand dyes, is make sure to consistently pick up the yarn in the same way. So when I was knitting this, I picked up the yarn I was going to use next and pulled it up and over the other yarn before I started knitting with it. So it just kind of, as you can see here, kind of twists the yarn around the previous color before you start knitting with it again. Let me just knit a couple of stitches and then show you what this looks like. So I don't know if you can see this, but you see how how the silver yarn is kind of trapped inside. It's been kind of pinned down by the pink as I started working with it. And then next time I worked with the gray, I could just pick it up and over the pink and do the same thing again. So it's really not complicated. It's just that the more consistently you do that, the cleaner the edge will look, especially if it's an exposed edge, like on this shawl. If it's going to get sewn up inside a seam or if it's inside a hat or something, then, you know, you don't really need to worry about it that much. But you don't want to do a lot of twisting. Like, I'm just taking the yarn and pulling it over the other one. I'm not actually like twisting them around each other because I just don't want to tighten things up too much. Like if you think about that inside a hat, like you don't want a whole rope of twisted yarns kind of running up, like squeezing against your head. And on the shawl, you don't want to tighten things up on that edge where you already need to keep things loose. So just, yarn up and over the previous color, and that's all you need to do. I've also had a lot of people ask me about, when you join that second ball of yarn, how to just keep the ends from getting too loose. And honestly, there's not really a great way to do that. I mean, you could tie, there's not really a place anything you can tie this to. If it's really bugging you, just weave in the end, I mean, get a couple of rows in and then just weave this in so it's not bugging you anymore. So there you go. All right, lovies. I am going to go start getting the podcast out to you, and I will see you in a couple of weeks. Hope you have a happy Thanksgiving if you're in the US, and I will talk to you soon. Bye.